if you know what's right, then you'll walk away. When the walls come down.
Test, test. Hello, everyone. Hi, I hope you're excited for the next three talks. My name is Sharon, and I will be chairing this session for you. We have a very, very exciting speaker lined up. For those of you that don't know him, his name is Vincent. He is a senior data professional and recovering consultant who worked as an engineer, researcher, team lead, and educator in the past. He is especially interested in understanding algorithmic systems so that one may prevent failure. He prefers simpler solutions that scale and worry more about data quality than the number of tensors we throw at the problem. He's also well known for creating calm code as well as a small dozen of open source packages. Currently employed at Probable, where he works together with scikit-learn core maintainers to improve the ecosystem of tooling. So his talk today is called Run a Benchmark, They Said. It will be fun, they said. Please join me in welcoming Vincent Warmerdam.
And we have the screen. Great. Run a benchmark, they said. It will be fun, they said. This is a story of something that happened at a company where I work. I work at a company called Probable. We are kind of the brand ambassador of scikit-learn. A bunch of the core maintainers work there. And I found myself in a position where I was going to be running a pretty big benchmark. The goal of this talk is to talk about many of the pitfalls that you can run into when you run a benchmark, but also to talk about this one benchmark in particular. So, as one does on Slack, you talk to scikit-learn core maintainers, so all day you talk about how people should do machine learning. And these days, it seems that people have converged on one standard flow, at least as a starting point. You do basic feature engineering, you throw that in a boosted tree of some sort, and then you have a pretty OK starting point for tabular tasks. This doesn't always hold true, but it does at least seem that the community has converged on a couple of these gradient boosted tree algorithms that have some sort of histogram heuristic inside of them, like GBM, XGBoost, but scikit-learn also has some of these tools. And this is all great. Like, we have pretty good tools at our disposal that weren't around 10 years ago. But it's not like boosted trees are all you need. That's not necessarily true. What really matters is the features that go into your machine learning model, also when you're doing tabular data. And that's why some of the scikit-learn people have also started a new project called Scrub. And this is a project that Probable also helps maintain. And I'm also in the Slack group. We talk about Scrub all day. What does Scrub do? Well, the short story is you have some sort of a table, some sort of pandas data frame or what have you, and Scrub is the thing that'll help you turn that into machine learning features. In particular, one of the tools that we have in here is something called a table vectorizer, and it really does as the name suggests. You give it your CSV file, and it will kind of just do the basic stuff of figuring out what the columns are, such that you have a pretty good representation for machine learning later down the line. If you do this inside of your Jupyter notebook, it looks a little bit like this. You have your machine learning model at the end. Let's say that's your histogram gradient boosted regressor thing. And then you have a table vectorizer over here. And you can see that we do stuff for the date time. We do stuff that's numeric. We also do stuff for like low cardinality categoricals. This is something that the table vectorizer does, and it can really save you a whole bunch of time when you're trying to get started. So this is all well and good, but then people in the Slack channel start asking questions. They start asking questions like, hey, that table vectorizer, back when we were working on it, it does assume that you're always going to want to use a boosted tree afterwards. And for a lot of people, that might be a fair assumption, but is that true for everything? And also, like, Scrub comes with some sensible defaults, we think, and but does that depend on the kind of task? Like, do we need different defaults for classification? Do we need different defaults for regression? Or are time series a different beast altogether as well? I was the person asking these questions, and then people came to the conclusion, like, Vincent, you should probably just benchmark this. Run a benchmark, they said. It'll be fun, they said. So I started wondering, like, what's a good source for data sets? Because I'm interested in answering these questions. I do think it's fair that if you do hyperparameter stuff, that you do base that on something. So it turned out that Kaggle actually has a bunch of data sets at the ready. And a lot of these data sets belong to these competitions. I'm sure people have seen this website. But the downside with some of these challenges is that you cannot just go ahead and download the data. There's a license attached. And the license typically states that you can only use the data set for the competition purposes. However, there is a certain type of competition on Kaggle that does have a really good license, and that will be the stuff in the Playground series. These are data sets that are semi-simulated, but they're based off of data sets that people actually uploaded to their platform. And there's still a competition attached to these data sets. You can also find that there are like thousands of people participating in competitions on these data sets, so even though there's no monetary prize, I can stand on stage and claim that these are data sets that people do take serious. And these are also data sets that are created to resemble a somewhat real-life task. So I did what any normal person would do, and I downloaded every single one of them that was a classification or a regression task that gave me my data sets, so that made me ready to do my first benchmarks. But I actually had to build a little library around these data sets just to manage them. Because you can imagine you have a data set, and that's like a CSV table, and then one of the columns in that data set, that's your target column, let's say. OK, and you got to keep track if it's classification or regression, because you kind of need different pipelines for both of them. But this is where a lot of the issues start. Because how on earth are you going to compare results? OK, well, let's do classification separate from regression. That's a pretty OK first step. But then you have to look yourself in the mirror and wonder, well, some of these data sets have different issues. Like, one challenge of one data set might be label imbalance. One challenge for another data set is that the regression task is a time series. We also have causal shenanigans in some of these data sets. Those are super fun, but they do give a bit of a different flavor. You also have data sets with many exclamation point labels. And you also have data sets with bad labels in them. So if I'm going to do any benchmarks, I should, of course, always keep in the back of my mind that doing an exercise on many data sets is very different than what I would actually do on a single data set. I don't have that much time to spend on every single data set, so I'm going to apply a blunt hammer, if you will. And it also means that I have to pick some kind of arbitrary metric and pretend that that's the thing I'm actually interested in. So for classification, I went with F1 score, but you can totally have a good conversation about whether or not that's been a great choice. But this is like the first issue I kind of hit my head against when I was trying to do this quote-unquote simple benchmark. There's also another thing, which I didn't expect, but that did involve me to do a bit of an investment. Inside of scikit-learn, we have a grid search object, and that's great. Grid search will automatically do cross-validation for you. So we'll do the train-test split, do that 5 times, every one data point in your data set will be used for testing exactly once. And moreover, if you play your cards right, then if you set the cross-validation, it will also do parallelism. And that's really cool, because that means that if I just run this one function, if I have 12 cores, it's basically going to consider them as workers, and it's going to totally take 5 of these workers for me. It's going to use all of these resources in parallel. And that's cool. But what if my machine has 12 cores or space for more workers? If I were to run grid search, I really have to be careful with the settings because it might not be able to really use full parallelism. And what I would hate is if one of these workers spends a bit longer and that's going to delay the next grid search to actually do its thing. Grid search kinds of objects are great if you're dealing with one data set, but I found that for this benchmark, I actually had to go a bit deeper. Like, these objects were not going to suffice for me. So the way I actually solved that is to go a layer deeper also in the stack. So scikit-learn has a dependency called joblib. And joblib is basically the library that handles all the parallelism and also is able to store the scikit-learn models for you. You've probably done the from joblib import dumps and loads to sort of dump and load your model. But inside of that library, there's also this object called the parallel object. And you can tell it to accept a generator. Now, the cool thing about that coding pattern is that you have a generator that's basically going to produce tuples of some sort of ID and then a function that can run. And that function contains all the code it needs to do one cross-validation, let's say. And then the generator can keep on fanning out tasks. And then this parallel object is going to fan that out to all the workers. And whenever a worker is done, it's just going to grab the next task from the generator. And this is great, because now I no longer have to worry about optimizing for the hardware that I am on. I can get a big machine, and it'll take full all the resources that it can, or a small one. But this observation really made my day. So this is the picture. You have a job generator, literally Python generator, goes to joblib, joblib sends stuff out. But you can go a step further. What you can also do, because it's a generator, you can add an if statement at the end. So we're going to keep on grabbing new tasks if the key of that task or the identifier of that task doesn't appear in a cache. What's great about writing code that way is that I basically have one script that's going to just loop over all the data sets that I have. And if I add one data set, I can use the same script, and it's never going to recompute values that I already calculated, because I also have a caching mechanism in the generator itself. And this will also work if you're doing stuff with cloud providers, by the way. It's a really, really powerful pattern. But you do have to go one layer deeper than scikit-learn. But this has been a huge, I would say, like time saver. Just taking the investment, taking an afternoon, writing a little bit of an abstraction like this to fit your problem better. But OK, I quote-unquote solved the scaling bits, and I figured a way out to sort of deal with the fact that metrics are different. The next problem is that models are super different. Just to give an example, you have a linear model called ridge regression in scikit-learn, and it's great. It's like linear regression, but it does some regularization too. However, it does not accept missing values. The linear regression model has no mechanism internally to deal with that, so if one appears, it's just going to immediately throw an error. The histogram gradient boosting regressor, when it's building the tree, you can kind of imagine that not available numbers, those just have to get propagated to one of the leaves as it's training. And it's kind of a mechanism to not really care about the missing values anymore. The algorithm has just found a way to deal with it. But if you then make a scikit-learn pipeline, you do have the awkward thing that the pre-processing components in your pipeline depend on the model that you have at the end. So that also involved a bit of manual labor to get right. Besides that, there's also this interesting thing that XGBoost, when you do classification, it wants integer labels. It doesn't accept string labels. I don't know why not, but that's the thing I've noticed. So you have to have a little bit of an extra step for that. And then, of course, we also have the bane of my existence, which is different date time formats. It is very well possible that one tabular data set that does time series has one format for the Dutch standard, let's say, and a different format for the US standard. And suddenly, you are writing logic for your data frame in order to run a big benchmark. All these problems, by the way, are totally doable. But when you start a benchmark, you don't expect stuff like this from biting you. And it's kind of weird, because maybe it should feel natural that you're going to hit these sorts of things when you're doing this kind of at scale. But initially, grid search kind of feels like it's this for loop, really. You're just looping over a bunch of models. But just implementing the basics already hits your head a few times. And it's going to get worse. Before that, though, I did have my first results. So I'm showing you this table to demonstrate that I actually did run this benchmark. And you don't have to take the numbers that serious. The main thing that's important is that I have a bunch of models. Those are all in the columns. And I have a bunch of rows. And those represent different data sets. And whenever there's something in bold, that means that that particular model was better. The numbers themselves don't matter that much. The main observation that I hope you see when you look at this is that it's kind of homogeneously distributed. It's not like there's one column that is always better than some other column. The models that I'm comparing here are all sorts of different ensemble models from different places. So this is CatBoost. This is the gradient-boosted model in scikit-learn. This is the histogram-boosted gradient model in scikit-learn. Random Forest, LightGBM, and XGBoost. So these are all kind of the ensemble models that you would expect. And if you, to me, at least, it seems on all the data sets that I tried, if I assume F1 score, the default settings are kind of OK, and they're all in the same ballpark. It's not like one model is obviously better than the other. Something interesting does happen, though, if you look at train time. So this is CatBoost. And CatBoost is an implementation of the ensemble boosted model trick, but they do something extra to the categorical values. And that takes a while to train. So the only conclusion that I've really been able to find when comparing all these different models is that even though CatBoost is accurate, it really has a good batting average compared to the rest, it is a fair bit slower to train. That's like one thing I did notice, as far as like general first observation goes. I did a similar exercise on memory usage. And again, the awkward thing when you look at these sorts of tables is you can kind of see, okay, there's one column that's kind of dark black, and that's maybe better. But if you look at the differences, it's not like it's twice as fast anywhere. They're still kind of all in the same ballpark. The only thing that I did think was interesting is that for some reason, classification has slightly less memory in XGBoost, but for regression, the memory use of scikit-learn was better. Probably due to the data sets or something like that. But the main point that I want to drive home at this point in time is that this was also my result that I shared with my colleagues. I did my first benchmark run, and the point was kind of, well, what do people think? Is this interesting? Can we do something with this? Or is it maybe not that useful? There were a couple of lessons we learned, though, when I did this. Those results were pretty interesting, but I also had a look at the logs. And that's always a good exercise to do, because you might see stuff that you initially would not expect. The thing with the table vectorizer is that it really tries to do date-time featurization, categorical featurization. There's an extra step for what we call dirty categories. Sometimes categories overlap in their name, and then you can wonder, well, maybe we should associate that with some similarity. But these two in particular, they take a categorical column, and they try to make features for it. But what if one of your data sets has a feature titled product ID? And what if every row in that table has a unique product ID? What if you tell a pipeline to then make features for it? Then for every product ID, it's going to make a separate column. And for every single separate column, the machine learning algorithm is going to try to do something with it. So even though I'm downloading these things from Kaggle, and even though these are all competition data sets, I still have to do data cleaning on some of these data sets. For machine learning purposes, this feature brings zero information to the table. But dropping this gave me like a 4 to 20% speed up in train time on these tasks. And this was also kind of a reminder that, again, I'm doing this with a blunt axe. If you're doing this in real life, you would also try to understand the data set. If you skip that step, you might get like huge train times. Another interesting thing, and I didn't show that in the original table, is I also threw a few linear models in the mix. There was one time when the linear model was slowest of all the different models. And it was super unintuitive, because you would expect that boosted models, many trees, are more expensive to train than a simple linear model. But this was due to the null and number removal. I had to do value imputation, because some of these data sets have missing values. And if you add that on top of doing things with a linear model, well, that actually turned out to be slower for some of these data sets, which I thought was interesting. Another thing that was interesting was also this: there was one task where the linear model actually beat all the boosted models. This was on a relatively easy data set, but I still think it's interesting to at least mention. I also want to mention this caching thing. This was really great, and it was going to save my bacon a few times in this whole exercise. But this is not the only variant of caching that I was actually applying. There is a feature inside of scikit-learn that allows you to say, well, if data is going into this one component over here, and this component is not the final component in your pipeline, then technically, for something that goes in, we can cache the thing that goes out. There's a mechanism inside of scikit-learn that can sort of do that for you. And the whole idea is that if you're going to be trying out lots of these different models, let's say I have 10 different models at the end over here, this featurization step should not happen 10 times. It should happen only once. And that's what the caching layer can definitely help with. If you want to turn that on, you just use your make pipeline as you would normally in scikit-learn. The only thing you got to remember is to actually give it a value for that memory keyword. That allows you to say, hey, here's a folder on disk, and put all the cached information there. By doing this, you can really save a lot of compute time as well. But I am still applying two levels of caching. One level of caching is on the estimator level. Thing goes in, cached thing goes out. And then there's also the, do I need to run this train loop in the first place? I forgot to turn this on initially. Turning this on was definitely a time saver. Another thing that I also just quickly want to mention that was great about the way that I do the caching thing here, there's a cloud provider in the Netherlands called LeafCloud, and they do carbon negative compute. And I don't mind that. I actually like that idea. So I could buy a big server there for rent, I should say, and run the thing. And it's all in a single VM, and it works great. However, there's also cloud providers like Modal, which have very likable developer experiences. And they can also just accept a generator of tasks. A lot of these cloud providers with big compute networks, I think Raylib also, they really allow you to do a lot of heavy lifting if your task is a Python generator. This is something I didn't expect, but it wasn't hard to change my script to run on LeafCloud or to run on Modal. That was actually fairly easy to do. And maybe we should use generators more, is kind of an observation here. This would not have been that easy if I didn't do the generator trick. I also want to mention, since it's my impression that the Modal people are listening, I really wouldn't mind if Modal would also allow me to do carbon negative compute. So Modal, I think you're listening. Maybe talk to the LeafCloud people and use their GPUs. I would love to pay extra for that. But having said that, generator workflow, it definitely saved my bacon a bunch of times, also because I can very easily switch compute providers. So, OK, I ran my benchmark. I shared all these lessons with my colleagues. Now what? Well, my colleagues are pretty critical. They are, after all, some of the core scikit-learn maintainers, and they are not easily impressed. And this is good. You want to be critical. Like, doubt the first result that you get in. And it's a really good attitude to have. But the first response I got from them was, well, Vincent, you're using the default parameters. Maybe that's not fair. Maybe what you got to do is actually do a bit of grid search or hyperparameter search, at least, because it could just very well be that the only thing that's different about these models is just their default. So that means I got to do not just looping over all the data sets and all the models, that means I get to do hyperparameter stuff as well. It will be fun, they said. And this is the part where I'm going to give the crowd a lot of warnings, because there are things that will go wrong if you're not mindful. This is the result of a hyperparameter sweep. The orange line represents the number, the metric, that I got without any hyperparameter search whatsoever. And this blue distribution after, those are all the scores from all the different hyperparameters that I tried. And you can look at this, and you can kind of see, OK, Vincent, but that's good news, because we have average score here, and we have better score there. So we can just grab the better score, call it a day, and we have a better model. Is that true? It isn't. What I did is I just optimized for the random search, the random seed here. So the only thing I'm optimizing here is just the random number that the algorithm gets. And the thing is, that has noise in your system. You can also pick a hyperparameter, doesn't matter, by the way. That will give you the same phenomenon. What you're looking at here is random sampling. But if you then pick the highest number and if you convince yourself that you're doing the right thing, that's an illusion. That's an illusion of progress. I did the same experiment, but now I did it with actual hyperparameter search. And what's kind of cool about that one is you can actually see that there's like a distribution for poor performing hyperparameters. And next to it is a distribution for high performing parameters. It's not always the case that you're going to get a pretty chart that looks like this. But the main thing I do hope to at least mention is that we should all be aware that there is noise in our system if we do hyperparameter search, right? And we need things that can help guard us against that. Otherwise, we're going to report optimistic numbers that don't hold in reality. And for that, I do want to mention one super-duper useful tool. The tool is called HiPlot. And it is basically just a parallel coordinates visualization. And what you're looking at here is 1,000 runs in a parallel coordinates chart via HiPlot. Every single line that you see here is basically a training run. And you can see that a training run had a specific hyperparameter, and it also had a score at the end. And what I can really kind of nicely do is I can just select the score, and I can just sort of see what happens if I only pick the highest performing scores. And notice something interesting when I do that, when I move this around, right? You can kind of start seeing a distribution. It starts to look like if I want to get the best model, I need an L2 regularization that's around here and a learning rate that's around here. So a lot of regularization, low learning rate. OK, yeah, that'll prevent overfitting. But notice the noise here. You don't need to optimize a random seed in order to get the effect. You can also just have hyperparameters that don't have an influence. Please do this exercise. And this is one of those moments where it does feel like it's great that we have LLMs, but a lot of the tools that we need are still missing. Visualizations can still surprise you, and this is definitely a handy utility if you're doing these benchmarks. There is more stuff, though. If you're going to do this grid search stuff kind of seriously, don't use grid search. For Pete's sakes, use random search. The whole idea with random search is that we're just going to sample within a search space, and we're able to give it an appetite for the compute that we are willing to spend. I get it. Grid search is in all the tutorials, and it's easy to explain, and that's the reason why it's there. But imagine adding, let's say you want to increase the resolution twice as big on both of these axes. Well, then your compute takes four times as long. And there's something just not pragmatic about that, especially because scikit-learn also has tools that will help you. What you can do is you can make a dictionary with all the names of your hyperparameters. You can then give it a distribution. And then scikit-learn has a parameter sampler that you can use directly to sample as many hyperparameters as you like. It will respect the random state. So if you sample the first 100, the first 100 will always be the same, even if you sample 1,000. And you can make this number bigger as your compute appetite increases. This is a really pragmatic way to do benchmarks properly. But we also have to talk about this other issue that's super duper awkward. I have improved my benchmark, I can claim, by changing the variation of what I'm doing. So this blue distribution is what I had before. Then I made a quote-unquote improvement, which is this orange distribution. And then I figured, hey, if something is worth doing, it's also worth overdoing, and I get an even better distribution. So I can fool myself by suggesting that the green thing is better than the blue thing. The difference is the number of cross-validations that I'm doing. This is kind of counterintuitive, but let me try to explain it. If you have a lot of cross-validations, that means that you're test set is small. That means that your train set is big. So that means that your training loop has more data to learn from. But does that mean that your model is better? Usually, after you've done your grid search, you're going to train your model on the whole thing. But then, hang on, the way I pick my cross-validation also has a big influence on the metrics. And there's an interesting statistical thing here that I just quickly want to mention. You can argue that when you have less training data, you get a worse model. The other side of the coin there is that you also get worse metrics. If your test set is bigger, you can kind of imagine the variance around your metric to be better. It has more statistical power, so to say. It's kind of like the beta distribution thing, kind of like the batting average. So, oh, yeah, this is also an awkward thing. You're going to have to think about where you're doing a benchmark properly. And if you want to make this even worse, ask anyone who is working in fraud. If you have class imbalance issues, that statistical power phenomenon is going to be even more smack dab in your face. So there is a remedy, and it's a bit unconventional. But one thing you can do is you can say, well, I have compute available to compensate. Instead of doing cross-validation where one data point can only be in one test set, you can also say, well, let's just shuffle everything. 20% is always the test set, and I can keep on bootstrapping new samples, and I can keep on bootstrapping, et cetera. I can keep on going that way. That way, I will have more samples in my distribution, and this can be seen as a remedy. But don't believe that this is enough, because if there's time in your data set, you shall never sample from the future. So if you're going to do the shuffling trick, make sure that you do respect the order in which time happens. If you have data where you're trying to do something between hospitals, then maybe have all the other hospitals be in the train set and then have this one other hospital be the separate test set and do some shuffling there. Shuffling on its own is definitely not enough. There's still like the problem that you got to worry about. And don't even get me started on if there's human annotators because there's bad labels and bias all over the place. But then I did start to wonder, like, what on earth am I doing in my benchmark? Like, am I seriously going to ignore all of these issues? And I was talking to my colleagues about it. And after a long discussion, I asked Gail, like, given that last statement that you have, like, why is the default in scikit-learn to have a grid search with cross-validation equal to 5. Like, what's the history here? And he told, and first of all, it used to be 3. But also he told me there's a different trade-off here because we're giving this out to the larger community and not everyone has access to the same compute. So all this reminded me of our field. The problem that we face isn't that we don't have the right number. The problem is that we try to match reality with a data problem. We take a problem in reality, we try to figure out a model for it, and then we come up with some sort of data solution, typically by doing optimal parameters sorts of things, right? A big for loop, grid search. But that doesn't necessarily imply that you have a solution for reality. And maybe the issue isn't so much we're not good at doing benchmarks, maybe the issue is we're not good at doing this translation. Translation error one way, translation error the other way, and this is basically the definition of the illusion of progress. There is, however, a remedy. The fix isn't sort of focus on the data problem. The fix is to focus on reality, and specifically, make the problem smaller. If you can make the problem very small and specific, it's more clear how to turn that problem into a data problem, and the risk of having a translation issue back is also just way smaller. The problem also becomes much easier, and you're allowed to solve a problem that's easier. It's a step that people sometimes forget. So what I did is I basically just stopped doing the entire benchmark, and I just focused on one particular kind of task, just time series. Turns out, for time series, there is this seasonal pattern, right, that you typically have in your data. Thing goes up at noon, that sort of a thing. And we have a featureizer in scikit-learn that's really good at generating those features. But that featureizer is not in scrub yet. And I was able to run a benchmark that shows that every model that you throw at it has a better score if you add that featureizer. So this is now on the roadmap. I ran a benchmark by making it much smaller than I initially hoped. But in doing so, I was actually able to find a thing that we could improve. So this is now on the roadmap. Scrub will have seasonal features at some point. We still have to discuss the details, but this is now something that will totally happen. And I hope that more people will do something similar. Go ahead and fix a simpler problem, and don't worry too much about the big, big benchmark. It's an illusion of progress sometimes. I hope you enjoyed this conversation. I work over at a company called Probable. Again, we try to do a lot of scikit-learn stuff. And if you like these kinds of lessons, we also try to educate. That's part of my job. We have a pretty good YouTube channel as well as a podcast called Sample Space. And if you think this stuff is interesting, please do check it out. But most of all, we also sponsor this event, and you can win a very fancy box of Legos this year. If you want to have a piranha you can rubber duck to, totally check out the challenge. Go to pydata.probable.ai. The challenge is pretty fun, and I think tomorrow, sometime at the end of the day, I will give the prize. You can also join our Discord if you have questions. And come talk to me if you want to talk about pickles, by the way. We are working on something. Thanks for listening.
Thank you so much, Vincent. I think we actually have time for one question. Thank you for all the insights.
Yay, one question.
Are there any questions from the audience? One question. I see that man going very quickly with his hand up.
Thank you. Honored to be the only one question. My question is about the overfitting, because I found that most of the time, if I try to optimize my training set, like you did, I actually did something similar to changing the randomness of the seed, mm-hmm. and I got exactly the same problem. But then also reducing... augmenting the CV as well, and so reducing the test set, I end up to overfitting a lot, and that's where I start to understand that the trade-off end up to be like having a larger test data for mm-hmm. cross-validation. So how did you handle the overfitting in your benchmark?
The best advice I have in general is to remember that you're just calculating a number, and it's really just a number, and maybe it's not something to take super duper serious, because in the end, we don't care about the number, we care about the effect in reality. So I would typically worry more about, hey, is this the right metric? Is the data quality up to snuff? Can I find reasons to doubt this data set? I have a colleague, Bob, who keeps telling me the data quality is immaculate. Do I trust Bob? Like, those are questions I tend to worry about more. Once that is there, there's also this thing of, if you're trying to do grid search or hyperparameter search, and you just notice that there's just some sort of plateau, like it's very hard to get the number higher, then maybe that's also fine. It can also be fine to sort of stop the hyperparameter search, not to go too deep into that rabbit hole, and see if there's other things that you might be able to do to make the application better. Like the main thing I want to focus on is, for me, this benchmark became a distraction of something that was actually useful that I was trying to do. And that's also my advice to you. Prevent the distraction from becoming a distraction. But I can talk algorithmic details on the floor if you have specific questions.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Vincent. Join me in giving a big round of applause to Vincent.